Good evening, everybody. Good evening to those remote too. I see Swag member Rich DiPantina and Laurel Shader, and I also see Al Pratt from the City of Portsmouth. And we have Stephanie Secord, who will be taking our minutes. So thank you, everybody. Welcome to everyone in the room. This is our final Swag meeting of this year, and I just want to thank everyone for being a part of this for the last year. It's been kind of recapping what we've done. It's been really interesting to see all the topics we covered. And so with that, I think we want to move into the agenda. So we have prepared some slides just to kind of keep us on track with our discussion, but we don't have any formal presentations or presenters tonight. It's more of an open discussion, a recap, and kind of talking about next steps.
There we go.
So, Brian, is it helpful? Should we introduce ourselves? Is that
helpful? Yeah, I think that probably would be good.
I'll start first. Andrea Amico, Portsmouth resident, SWAG co-chair with Brian Getz.
Katri Hillman, Portsmouth resident, a citizen member, SWAG.
Sorry.
Don Grillin, assistant fire chief, Portsmouth resident.
And David Buse, a state representative.
Dingle McCarran, City Councilor.
Kim McNamara, Director of the Portsmouth Health Department.
Cliff Lazenby, City Councilor.
Brian Gibbs, City of Portsmouth.
And I think we'll go to the folks on the call, which I'll start. Rich DiPantina, if you want to introduce yourself.
Hi, Rich DiPantina, Portsmouth resident.
Laurel Shader.
Hi, I'm a senior scientist at Silent Spring Institute. I'm a technical advisor to the PEAS CAP and the lead investigator of the PFAS REACH study.
Thank you so much. I think that's all of our SWAG members that are present, both in person and virtually. So next slide, please. So we did our welcome. Thank you again, everyone, for being here. Before we move on, Brian had sent out some meeting minutes from our September meeting. So we just, I think, need a motion to approve those minutes, or I guess first ask if anybody has any changes or anything they want to update in those minutes.
So moved.
Oh. I don't think any changes to the minutes, but there are a couple of things in the minutes I'd like to discuss.
Okay, great. So we have a motion. Do we need a second?
A second.
Okay. And is everybody in favor of approving the September meeting minutes? Okay. Anybody not in favor? Okay.
Could you tell me who made the motion and the second?
Deglin made the motion and Cliff seconded.
Thank you.
So next we'll turn it over to Brian just to give us a recap of the Madbury tour that we did back in October.
Great. Thank you, Andrea. I didn't remember the day, but there it is on the slide. October 22nd, it was a Friday. We were fortunate that six total members, which include myself, and then our quasi member Al Pratt. So on the top left, you can see everybody that was able to attend on that Friday, and we did a virtual tour of the water system, compliments of Al Pratt, who put this video together, which I think will make available broader to the broader public in some shape or form. Did a great job of showing the water where it starts, the reservoir, the watershed, all the way to the water treatment facility. Spoke a bit in the video about the particulars of the water treatment facility that we get a little bit about how much water, where, the amount, and then the wells, and then on in from Madbury down the hill to Little Bay and under Little Bay and back up in Newington and then throughout the full Portsmouth system. So it gave a great overview of the water system in whole. And then everybody took a tour of the Madbury Water Treatment Facility. That's the second photo in the middle. Shows Al showing what he's standing on, which is essentially a flocculation basin, which is the first phase of the process that filters out the water. And there's also the dissolved air flotation units that settle up, the bigger solids, and then our filtering system, and then what the photo on the right shows everybody down in the filter gallery, which is quite impressive just to see. You're basically in the center of the system to some degree with all the monitoring and the valves and controls and that. So it was great showing everybody around, and some those that attended, I guess I have a biased impression of the place myself, but it'd be nice to maybe share thoughts on what it was like to actually go there yourselves, I guess.
I'll come on real quick. It was one of my favorite things I did as a city councilor. Fascinating to see. And among many things that were interesting about it, I felt very reassured that we have a strong and knowledgeable staff that we're looking after things. There's a lot of smart science and consistent protections in place to make sure things are running well. So I thought it was a real fascinating thing to see. And then my only little hesitation, I don't remember who brought it up, was it was so informative that it almost feels like it could be vulnerable if there was a bad actor who understood how the system worked as well as you explained it. So
there's
so
much we want to talk about.
Exactly. I don't want to be too hard on it, but the video was so good and so helpful and so informative that you just sit like, wow, boy, it'd be awful if somebody took advantage of that. But, not to take away from all the causes of it, because it was really very impressive. So thank you.
I just want to say that it was also fascinating to just sort of be able to have some of your own personal, just some of the things you kind of take for granted, maybe dispelled a little bit. So last summer, we had a very, very dry period, and then all of a sudden we had a very, very wet period. And I think I was one of a lot of people who thought, well, gee, that's great. That means no problems, for Portsmouth in terms of water. But one of the things that I learned that surprised me is because a lot of that rainwater was washing over areas where very little had washed over for years. A lot of particulate matter, organic matter, chemicals, and things like that were going into the system that had to be removed from the system before they went into the taps. So the process of sort of learning how that's done and how the folks at the water treatment facility kind of react to situations like that was very informative. And it really does help you appreciate the work that goes on there.
I had asked about the pipe bringing the water to Portsmouth and surrounding communities. And so then I noticed the article on paper about the infrastructure funding to replace that. But I was very appreciative that you folks have a system in place if that were to fail, that to provide water still. So that was reassuring. I really liked the tour. It was great.
Yeah, I found the tour to be very informative. One of the things I appreciated how we had sort of discussed as we were going through that day was the sort of modern marvel behind the engineering of it from some 50 years ago, how essentially we just had to sort of tweak it and upgrade it, and that the what the Army Corps of Engineers designed so many years ago still works efficiently, effectively. We have these redundancies built in with the safety factor. So. Certainly, I appreciated the opportunity, and thank you, Brian, and to all the staff there that took time out of their day from being productive to gated ops. So thank you.
Yeah, I echo everything that's been shared, and just I think the technology was the coolest part for me, like how you guys can just see things real time with all the systems, stay on track with all that stuff. And I thought the video was really helpful because it is hard to kind of get to all these places. So to be able to see a video of a lot of places really helped put things in perspective. I think when we turn on our tap, a lot of people don't really think about where that water came from and what it's been through before it came. So it helps give you some perspective.
Yeah.
So I really appreciated it. I thought Al did a wonderful job, and I was very thankful for the opportunity.
Great. Yeah, and that's part of one of the things I said for our video, we'll probably, I won't say we'll dumb it down, but there's certain components of it. But in this day and age, I mean, I speak for the water supply industry, mainly. Everyone is concerned night and day about, you know, a bad actor, and we're doing what we can to, you know, we have things that maybe we didn't show you that give us maybe, you know, the early indication of something that may be going on. But, you know, that, you know, nothing is, you know, you're only as good as your last sample that are, you know, it's, we're 24/7. So it's just that those things are out there, but you know, we gotta move forward best we can, which is what we're trying to do. So thank you. And yes, very much thanks to Al and staff there at Madbury.
I think I said this over there, but I could see some version of this being beneficial periodically for city councilors or some other board, because it really is, gives a lot more depth to a very important core city function. So it was, even if it was the video and you know, some version of the video in a shorter tour or something,
right?
It was really interesting.
It's great.
So now we wanted to kind of do a brief recap of our last year and the things that we, some kind of the high level things. So our SWAG was approved by the city council last October, and we held an initial meeting in December just to kind of organize and discuss logistics. At that meeting, we chose two co-chairs, both Brian and myself. We thought it would be a good balance to have city staff as well as community members helping to organize the meetings, which I think has worked really well. And we've met four times this year so far. Tonight will be our fifth time. We've covered a variety of topics, which I'll be sure to, you know, to bring up on the next slide. We did have some changes in membership. So Lindsay Carmichael, Portsmouth resident, did move to Florida. So she resigned, as well as Russ Osgood, who was the Portsmouth firefighter representative on our SWAG, resigned due to retirement. So we were very excited to welcome Assistant Fire Chief Bill McQuillan, who joined us later in the year. Early on, we established a SWAG overview document and some SWAG goals that we all reviewed and agreed on. And the SWAG document is up on the city website, and we're grateful that we do have a website that has our reference documents, meeting minutes, videos. So it's a place not only for us to reference, but also for the community if they have questions about the things that we've covered. And then lastly, for our final meeting of this year, our hope is to process our meetings, have an open discussion, and decide on some recommendations for a final report that the SWAG will send into the city council. And Brian and I will prepare to give some brief remarks at the last city council meeting of the year on December 20th. So that's just kind of our overview. So I broke down all the meetings that we've had and the topics that we've discussed. And it was actually really nice to go back and be like, wow, we covered a lot of ground this year. You know, we got an overview of the Portsmouth water system, a pretty in-depth presentation by Brian and Al. We also talked about PFAS at the national level and what other states are doing to address it. We heard from New Hampshire DES's toxicologist about how New Hampshire regulated PFAS, and we learned more about PFAS here in the city of Portsmouth and some of the tap sampling projects that we've done. In June, we heard from Ken Lynchy from the Portsmouth School Department just to talk more about how the school has to stay on top of water regulations and any additional testing that they may be required. And then we also learned more about PFAS community organizing and how it has really changed the national conversation and action that we've seen. And also Representative David Muse and Senator Perkins Kolga gave us a nice overview of some legislation on water, which was really helpful for us. And then at our September meeting, we heard from Brandon Kernan, who's head of the Drinking Water Bureau at New Hampshire DES, about private well owners, which we don't have a ton of those, but it was really helpful to kind of hear his perspective and how that pertains to residents in our city. And then we also heard a presentation from Al about climate change and how that's affecting drinking water, followed by an update from Brian on the reopening of the Haven Well and some of the testing that's been done there. So
I feel like we've covered a lot of ground. We had some really amazing presenters, and I feel a lot more knowledgeable after this last year of the SWAG. And I would definitely say that this year was a success in all the meetings that we had. Slide, please.
Once in a while. Sure, again.
Try clicking on this.
No.
Delay for some reason. Okay.
So early on in the year, too, we established some goals of things that we wanted to accomplish this year. And same thing, it was really nice to see that we pretty much achieved almost every goal or partially achieved it. So we did have an overview of the water system and what's tested for. We did learn more about contaminants of concern the city is facing. I said partially achieved because I think this is evolving data, you know, and something that we're going to continue to discuss. We did have an overview of pending legislation and potential future legislation. Again, we achieved that, but that's also an evolving conversation that I think we'll continue to have. We reviewed New Hampshire PFAS guidelines and the reasoning behind that. We talked about wanting to host a clean water forum for local residents to provide Q&A and more education. And so we agreed at the last meeting we were initially going to try to fit that in November, but realized that it was kind of a hectic time for folks. And so we opted to do that early next year. So that still is on our radar and our plans to do that next year. So not achieved yet, but it will be. And then lastly, we wanted to report back to the city council by the end of 2021 or sooner as needed. And we will be achieving that at the end of this year. So again, I thought we did a really nice job of setting goals and really achieving most of them or partially achieving them or plans to achieve them. So I just wanted to point that out and say that I think we made really great progress as well. Next slide. So next, so this is a finding through the National PFAS Contamination Coalition, which I'm a member of. I was given the opportunity to work with the National Research Defense Council. They ask community members from all over the country to submit tap samples for testing that would be done with a lab called Urofins that can do a more targeted list of PFAS. Right now, Urofins just introduced a list of 70 analytes that they can do, where most labs do, you know, anywhere from like 28, 29, some can go up to 56. So Urofins by far is the most comprehensive. And so as part of this pilot study, I did send in one tap sample from a residential tap that gets its water from the city of Portsmouth. And it confirms some things that we already knew. So we did know back in April, we talked about some tap sampling that testing for bees had done in collaboration with the city of Portsmouth. And we did find low level PFAS ranging from like 6 to 9 PFAS, depending on where the sample came from, going up as high as about 15.4 parts per trillion. In the Urofin sample, they found 7 PFAS totaling 50 parts per trillion. And they detected one PFAS that we've never tested for before called PFPRA at 35 parts per trillion. So this was definitely a new finding. And so if we can go to the next slide, we want to share a little bit about what we know about PFPRA. We know that it's a short chain compound, which means it's a C3, it has 3 carbons. We don't have any toxicological data on this. And let me back up and say that, so this is a pilot study and the results are not published yet, but NRDC, the group that is organizing the study, did share the individual data with the communities who have participated in, and they're working on compiling a published report that can be publicly shared. So I did have to get special permission to be able to share this information tonight because it's not a published report yet. And I did notify Brian, and who we've also had conversations with New Hampshire DES. I've talked to Senator Shaheen's office, the EPA has been notified as well. So we have been taking this information and sharing it with people, but it's not something that I can publicly release yet. The report isn't available, but so with that, I just wanna say what we know about PFPRA, which is, again, it's a short chain compound. As according to New Hampshire DES, there is no toxicological data on it. So we don't know anything about it in terms of its effects. It's not regulated by the EPA, nor is it required to be tested for by public water supplies. In fact, EPA released its updated roadmap a few weeks ago, and this compound isn't even on their radar. So they are aware of it now, and we're trying to, you know, stay on top of that, request some technical assistance from them so we can better understand what this means. But even though it's not regulated and it's not on anyone's EPA's radar, it has been detected in many other sources. So in conversations with New Hampshire DES, it has been detected in the polar ice caps. It's been found in bottled water in Maryland. It's been detected in rainwater. And it's also been found in other water supplies in different states. So again, as part of this pilot study, they're testing multiple communities across the country. I can tell you that Merrimack, New Hampshire has also found this PFAS in their drinking water as part of this pilot study. So we know that it's not just Portsmouth, it's also Merrimack, and other communities as well are finding it. What else do we know? We know that reverse osmosis filtration can effectively filter it from water. Granular activated carbon filtration is less effective because it's a shorter chain compound, which means it can slip through the carbon filter sooner. As of right now, only one commercial lab that we know of can test for PFPRA and validate the results, and that's Eurofins. I guess more to come as the pilot study wraps up and data collection from other communities are finished, and a published report, hopefully early next year, will give us some more context so we can share it. But I felt it was important to share this with the Safe Water Advisory Group. You know, I certainly was concerned when I saw it. I want to better understand what it means for our community. I think where I'm at is it was found in one tap sample. So I think we absolutely need to do some additional testing to confirm its presence, not only at the tap, but I also think we need to think about where it might be in the sources of Portsmouth. And so I guess I'll pass it to Brian if he wants to add anything to that discussion.
Thank you, Andrea. I did the polar ice cap, this stuff, the story of PFAS just gets, you know, more and more involved. The polar ice cap report I was able to pull up, they took two samples. So they do ice cores. So ice cores are valuable in many ways. They're like the tree rings. People talk about looking at tree rings. You can look at past weather data, mostly from a tree ring. They can track fires and big occurrences of weather patterns and stuff. But the ice cores, they can get sort of more of a historical perspective. I know I've spoke to Andrea about, you know, the fact that we get these samples for PFAS, and like, if I had a time machine, I would be able to go back in time. It's like, okay, we found this at this level, but is that more or less, or, what is your reference point? I know I've had my blood tested because I was an affected party when I was a consultant and I worked at PEAS. I myself know that, well, the blood data shows that 20, 30 years ago, everybody had higher levels in them, and they're coming down. And that gives me some bit of a calm response when I see my levels are high, but yet compared to people 20, 30 years ago, they sort of sit in the middle. So that's okay. Thinking, but the ice core they took, they found PFPRA, they had two samples, and they found a range of 0.5 to 29 parts per trillion in the ice. So this essentially tells you, and this was up in Canada, they took ice cores up into ice caps, the Devon ice cap, and the other one is the Mount Oxford ice field up in Canada. So basically what they're doing is getting, what the precipitation had in it. So I think, like Andrew said, rainfall. The other thing, a lot of the focus health-wise has been on the long chains because they accumulate more in your body. They stick around longer, but The short chain compounds are the ones that are basically being replaced, are replacing the long chain compounds. They don't stay in your body as long. In fact, you know, the half-lives are significantly less than the long chains, but they're more easily transported. So now I'm not an expert on this, but this is basically what, you know, I've heard from literature, from, you know, the science people and from the state. The state toxicologist, Jonathan Patali, he chimed in a little bit on this for us, as the state is looking into this, certainly with Merrimack and us both having detected it. So they too are, you know, doing the research of this, and his take on it is, though there is not toxicological data, the fact it's a three-chain compound and some data has been found for the four-chain compounds, so he's inferring a bit that, you know, the safety levels or the factor of where these would be regulated would be somewhat higher than PFOS and PFOA and PFHXS. But that said, it's new. So, you know, we sit here with, you know, the finding that, you know, I don't want to say or wish it on other water systems or anywhere else that's sampling, but, you know, my gut feel is, you know, this is probably more prevalent everywhere as well. And so certainly any place that has, you know, PFOA, PFOS, or the, you know, the compounds that are found, you know, most readily around for water systems, I would have to think too that you know, they're gonna find those. So the other thing we'll be faced with, and this won't stop, I go to many a conference, I'm on a American Water Works committee that looks at this, both on the regulation side, the research side, and that, and they provide advice as well, and I ask a lot of questions of this group. In fact, Andy Ian of Eurofins, he's the I believe president or whatever chief technical person, is on this committee as well. The labs are, you know, it's great to be the lab, to be the first one to do something that nobody else can do. So that's great for the labs, but it isn't all that helpful for the water systems because, you know, lo and behold, here's a result and you want to know what it means. And well, you know, it means maybe it's there. The one little caveat they do throw out, the shorter the chain, I guess the harder it is for the laboratories to fully differentiate that compound. So that's another thing as well. So what we've done after, you know, Andrea talked to us about it, we, you know, immediately tried to check ourselves with the lab that we use. We use Alpha Atlantic Analytical. They, when contacted Al, and maybe Al, you could maybe jump in and just give an overview of what the labs have said to us, because we use Alpha for our testing, and we wanted to see if they could do PFPRA.
But. Yeah, sure. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
So I talked to a lab director there at Alpha Analytical, and they looked into doing this. It's not typically one of the analytes that they look at. They're pretty focused on EPA approved methods. So there's no approved method for analyzing for this compound. They looked in to see if they could do it. They would need to get standards to be able to calibrate their equipment. And that's as far as the conversation went with them. I contacted another lab that's very reputable out in California, Vista Labs. And they said that they could do the same thing. They'd have to gear up to do it. They'd have to work through with their research and development group and get the standards for that. And we would need to be able to provide at least 50 samples to afford them that sort of investment into getting it done. So that's where that ended. I think all the labs now that we're talking about it, they've heard about it. Maybe they're going to be thinking about how they can step up. And ideally, it would be great if this was included in the 533 method, the EPA-approved method. You know, I could see that being a way that this goes further and gearing these labs up to include it into the standard methods. If it is ubiquitous, everybody's going to be seeing it. There may be something that can be told by the different levels that we're seeing around the nation for this compound. So that may be a good thing that comes out of this study.
Yeah. And we did, so lastly, you know, we talked and Andrea makes a good point, you know, there's only one sample in time in the system. You know, we get sample at the sources. Again, our first pitch to that was to talk to Alpha, who does our sampling, and they said no. So, you know, our latest round, which Al took the samples either last week or a couple weeks ago, are quarterly required samples. So those are still just doing the EPA method. But I got quotes, and originally the ballpark quote was about $400 to do a sample. So that was close to what we're paying now. But then today I got the final quote, and it's $1,000. So if we want to do additional sampling, you know, granted, you know, we've got a budget that can absorb some sampling, but $1,000 a sample, you can see why the other labs are going to want to get into this. You know, so, you know, we're still investigating that. I mean, working with the state did respond back that, you know, just like Al said, in order to do a robust set of validated samples, you kind of need, well, you, for us, and we've done this before, when we were in the earliest phases of sampling for PFAS overall, we've done duplicates before where you send to two different labs and they have different methods. And fortunately, we never really came across, you know, you get a few little blips here or there, and comparatively, but for the most part, you know, all the samples we've had and all the labs we've used have been, you know, really pretty consistent. So that's the other thing we kind of wanted to do too, is like, ideally, and then you have EPA, that's the whole thing about an EPA method. The EPA has finally gone through and then they certify labs, and there's a very rigorous process a lab has to go through to be EPA certified. And this is part of the delay. I know there's frustration of people that, gee, why does it take so long? It's like, you know, because it's very complex, complicated, and, you know, the you know, just to get the equipment itself to be able to run these tests is, you know, in the order of, you know, $250,000 to $500,000. So lab just doesn't run out and, you know, say, well, let's get this piece of equipment and start doing a test. And then they have to get validated, they have to get staff, they have to have all the quality control things in place. So we're working on it. We'll continue to work with Andrea and see where we can go with it.
Yeah, just a couple other things I'd add. You know, I know I asked of the state if they had any funding to help support additional testing, not only here, but also in Merrimack, and they said at this time they don't. I asked what about American Rescue Plan funds, and they said that was a little bit more restrictive. They could use that to support infrastructure and hiring, but not so much sampling. However, just last week, I believe, the infrastructure package did pass and get signed into law, and that allocated $10 billion for PFAS across the nation, which is, like, honestly mind-boggling to me. That's just so much money and so much needed. And it's my understanding in conversations with Senator Shaheen's staff that hopefully those funds will be more flexible and the state will receive those and be able to use that to help support additional funding. And so, you know, I think we'll continue to stay in close conversations with the congressional delegation, New Hampshire DES, and certainly your state reps too, about just trying to make sure we have adequate funding to be able to support additional testing. Because I think this is the future of PFAS. I said that to Brian the other day on the phone. As labs become more advanced and they can look for more, we're going to find more. And so, you know, we need to be able to figure out what this means for communities and for water systems. And we also, and again, this compound wasn't even in the EPA's roadmap, so it wasn't even on their radar. And so we know that it is now, and hopefully when this study is completed and is published, it will help support the need not only for EPA to look more expansively for PFAS. I know, you know, in the National Coalition, there's a big push to regulate PFAS as a class. I think this is just another example of why, you know, from a community perspective, that's really important, because we just can't be doing this one at a time, kind of this whack-a-mole approach. It just really has not worked. And so, think that's all I have to say for now, and I know our next
Just a question, since I found it in ice caps in Canada. Is the assumption that, just say I'm not a scientist, that's fine too, but is the assumption that this is atmospheric?
Yes, okay. It gets carried in the atmosphere. I mean, that Merrimack, their whole issue is the smokestacks of the manufacturer, Saint-Gobain, and how it got carried in the rainfall. So yeah, the ice caps, and they said it is from, it appears in the core, the part of the core is from 1990 on. So that's essentially where this became, you know, more used around the world.
One of the things that I'd like to discuss if we have time tonight is, I know we're talking about PFAS, but there are thousands and thousands and thousands of chemicals that are going to come up every, you know, time the EPA. Every time there's a new list to come out to test just five of them, we're going to find more compounds. And we really should be looking at a more global picture, you know, lots of testing for lots of compounds in our environment. So I'm not sure if that's the purview of this group, but it's certainly the interest of environmental health in our department. So if we could use these infrastructure dollars, which we probably won't see again for a very long time, to get the comprehensive testing you're talking about, but include a lot of the things that we're dealing with.
So I think we have a slide, Brian, for the open discussion. And I welcome, you know, I had a couple of things that we could talk about, but obviously would love to hear any questions or reactions or thoughts on the PFPRA, but also anything else that we...
We did have one question. With PFPRA, has it been connected to a manufacturing process or burning of any type of material, or do we know how it gets into the environment?
Not that I know of. I don't think there's a lot of information, and I think we're all still trying to come up to speed, but I know it's been found in Merrimack, not included in this pilot study. It's also been found in North Carolina, where they also have a lot of industry. Comores does a lot of PFAS manufacturing there too. Again, it was detected in bottled water in Maryland. So, you know, it's in rainwater, so I don't know for sure, but it sounds like it's not just unique to Portsmouth or Merrimack or New Hampshire. It certainly sounds like it's a widespread problem, and one that the EPA needs to be focusing more on. Certainly, if it's more prevalent in drinking water systems. And the other thing to note, part of this pilot study is they collected samples from communities that had known PFAS contamination. But it was a mixture of communities in the sense that, you know, they could have been impacted by DOD military sites, or they could have been impacted by industry or landfills. You know, it was kind of do you live in a community that's been affected by PFAS, and are you willing to submit a tap sample? You know, and some of them were municipal water supplies, and some were private wells too. So it's kind of a mix, and that's where I was only given for the data that I submitted, the one tap sample I submitted, but you know, I don't have the comprehensive data yet, but I'm really anxious to get it and kind of see how we compare and what else they found. Because I think this, you know, these kinds of studies are helpful, although they're hard to be the first or one of the first to find something that you don't have a lot of answers for. That's a hard position to be in, but it's necessary because we have to continue to progress what we know and what we find and how we can learn more about this.
In speaking about this, I mean, not every water system is like Portsmouth. There are many places where, and I've talked to peers out and about, that they literally, when they order up their, you can tell the lab what you want to sample for. So there's some places that in New Hampshire that say, we only want the four. Don't tell us what the other ones are. We're regulated for the four. Just give me the four. I know there's places, a lot of places, most around the country are just the two, which are PFOA and PFAS, and then the 70 part per trillion, and the same thing. I dug into data. I'm constantly, you know, hearing about other systems and stuff. So I go on the websites and I see, you know, what are they sharing? And there's a lot of them that literally only talk about PFOA and PFOS. Those are the two that EPA has. They haven't added HXS or NA. They're talking about Gen X and PFBS. You know, so those are, you know, we're moving down the road of maybe 4 to 6 compounds, but so we see what many others may have. And again, just like I wish for the time machine that might go back 10, 20, 30 years, with all this legislation and all this stuff, it's like just somebody somewhere at the federal level send everybody a bottle and fill it up. And then we'll have, you know, a few million samples that the labs can run and have a field day with, but then we'll have a true accounting of what's out there. And to speak to Kim, it's like maybe we really have a sense of what are we all dealing with and, you know, the extent of that, you know.
And also sources like, excuse me, what we consume, what we are taking into our homes and our workplaces and, you know, where that's ending up in the environment. Is it possible, and does this group want to think about this, that if there's this much money in the infrastructure bill, it can be devoted to testing some of it? Do we want to, you know, think about when UNH put in a lab specifically for this so we could have ready access? You know, grad students are a great free resource of work. And it could be maybe enhancing their environmental programs. I don't know what other people think about that, but if we could have more local capacity built in, that would be really helpful.
Good point. I know right now New Hampshire DES uses zero fins to send all their PFAS work to. They don't test for the 70. Like, this is a new capability of the lab, but so they already are kind of sending it out of state. So that's a good point to make for sure. In house, maybe keep the cost down too and make it more accessible to state.
And have a good filtration system so we're not taking everybody's PFAS and discharging it here in New Hampshire.
Excuse me, but Laurel had her hand up a minute ago. I can't see if she still does.
Oh, yeah. Thanks, Stephanie. I just wanted to follow up on the PFPRA. I think it's good to have this heads up about a wider range of PFAS chemicals. Portsmouth has done a good job at, you know, looking ahead and looking beyond just the ones that are required to be tested for now. And I think it's a good reminder that there could be other PFAS in the water. This kind of ties to the comment made just now about working with the academic labs. Haven't had myself the hands-on experience with mass spectrometry, but I know there's different types of mass specs. And for the really lightweight PFAS like PFBA, sometimes you need a high resolution mass spec to really confirm the identity of the PFAS. So I don't know if that's what the Eurofins lab use, but it might be good to consult with some academic labs that have the high res mass spec, see if they might be willing to run a couple of samples just to see, you know, if they're seeing the same thing in the water. And I was curious, I know Chris Higgins a while back did the testing of the other water samples. I didn't know if this was on his analyte list and if you'd seen it earlier.
I'd have to go back and look more at his presentation.
We never got a hard copy. We do have a video of his presentation, but same thing, he hasn't published that I know of, so.
No.
I can follow up with him and ask.
Yeah. I mean, I don't doubt that this could be in the water, but it would just be good to have that, you know, some extra confirmation. And the academic labs might be a bit ahead of where the commercial labs are in terms of the high resolution methods that can really, you know, give you a high level of confidence about the identity of these lightweight PFAS. Thanks for sharing it.
Yeah, I wonder too if it's something to think about with the split samples, you know, if there's an academic partner and a commercial, you know. Because right now, Eurofins, as far as we know, is the only commercial lab that can even test for this compound, which makes it great. Thank you very much. So, anyone else? Any thoughts?
Did they tell you when their data may be done and published?
They were hoping for early 2022 when I asked about permission to be able to share in this platform. They were still wrapping up a couple more sample collections at a couple communities, and then we're hoping to work on the report kind of, you know, through the end of this year into early next year, and then
be able to publish something peer-reviewed is their ultimate goal. So hopefully early next year is what I'm being told.
Quick question for just trying to take some of those off the table in terms of thoughts on SWAG membership for next year. Is this a Blueprint committee or is this a, so I guess first, if we want to continue, I'm happy to, we can reappoint this as a Blue Ribbon committee. I'm going to change the title of these going forward. not the title of SWAG, but like the Mayor's Blue Ribbon. No, I just think it should be like a council committee. I think like we should just call them like council committees. So in terms of membership, if there's, thoughts, I think I do appoint them next year. So I'm happy for anybody, you don't have to state it right now, but if you'd like to, from a community standpoint, be reappointed, please reach out to me and we can do that. And then one thing in terms of future topics for next year, the conversation of PFAS is important for a lot of reasons specific to Portsmouth, but
fucking moron.
I think it's important to have at least touch on some other topics as well, other contaminants that are an issue. Don't want anybody to get the impression that this is the only thing that we should be thinking about or the only thing that community members should be thinking about as well. So understanding that and expanding our scope there, lead is still, not here in Portsmouth maybe necessarily, but it's everywhere. And then some of the contaminants that, could be ingested, just because of, like manufacturing. I would like to expand the topic there. And then the last thing in terms of future topic, where we get feedback from the public, would love to have that as early as possible to help kind of guide where we go as a community. I think hearing from the public and their thoughts and concerns around safeness of their drinking water, something that would be really good to have early. And then maybe if people are concerned, have ways, like we mentioned, this will be removed through reverse osmosis, but maybe some just takeaways for people to say like, hey, this is how you go about doing that if you were concerned around that, but in an informative kind of educational process, I think some action items, because the last thing I want is like, hey, there's we're expanding it more than just PFAS, bringing in other chemicals, and then kind of throw our hands up. It's something that actionable items that we can do, and resources there. But and then I think we can't bring the whole city of Portsmouth, and I missed the tour, so we'll do that tour next year as well for the council. But to understand how really smart people are thinking about this in an enormous amount of time. Brian, I'm sure, was looking at Brian Getz, for those listening at home. I'm sure was reading, all of the information on, PFPRA, there was probably some light reading that he was doing outside of just working hours as well. He's got a lot that's going on. So just, highlighting some of the city employees that do put the time into this and then are very committed to making sure that, we are safe. And it's a passion of theirs to make sure that, we know what's in our drinking water. And so the confidence around the city employees that this is something that everybody takes incredibly seriously. And more information is always better because we can change our path, but the folks that are at the helm are really passionate about that. I think that would go a long way for helping people understand what it is that give them some level of safety in a world that is full of uncertainty. So I guess that's a lot, but
I think that's great. And I think in terms of getting feedback from the public, one great way that we could do that is at the water forum that we want
to have
this year. And I think that's also a platform where we can talk about what we know and like filtration, if people want to go that route, so I think that's all.
Yeah. Well, thank you for those comments. That's great to hear. And
of course, we're pressed on by Andrea keeping us at the cutting edge too, because
yeah.
I mean, you know, it may be stressful in some respects, but I think especially through this group too, we learned a lot together, and you know, so much is yet unknown, and that's a scary realm to be in. But we can at least answer those questions. Same thing about those water systems that maybe only sample for two. And like, do you know what your other ones are? Well, no, we don't. And it's like, well, you know, would you rather know to some degree?
Sure.
Some say, you know, oh, we'll just wait.
Well, we like knowing the, you know, the known unknowns. We know a lot more of the unknowns than other communities. So, you know, it's a good, you know, it's good. But with that comes a responsibility, I think, to make sure that, you know, we talk about all sides of the issue, just because we're forward and, you know, talking about things that, you know, only the leading, you know, the people that, you know, as you mentioned, people that are just testing for two or four, you know, to make sure that, you know, we're contextualizing it for folks is important as well. But we got to keep pressing forward, because it doesn't get, you don't get any funding from the, you know, $10 billion is a lot of money. You can, you know, I can't say I'm not partially responsible for any $1 billion, you know, and Andrea, I think, can honestly lay a claim to being partially responsible for, you know, getting that to be seen on a federal level. So, you know, we got to keep pressing on that as important.
Well, I have a few ideas just from reading through the notes and prior conversations, so these might not be appropriate. I'm just putting them out there. But to follow up on this, also what's in our soil ends up in our water. We have a real agricultural movement in this area and backyard gardens. And I'm always a little concerned after so many hundreds of years of environmental abuse, you know, what people are growing their vegetables in. So I don't know if that kind of sampling can be wrapped into this, or maybe that's a separate discussion. And it also brings up prior discussions we've had in the health department and with other committees and boards that I've sat on, that what we really need is public education broadly when it comes to environmental health. And we even talked about things, and slap my wrist for this, but about, you know, if McIntyre space became available, maybe not a community campus, you could have maybe a space for public education, and have, doesn't always have to be city staff, we can bring in academic speakers, national speakers, but it really is that public education that we need, so people understand this on a broader level so they can make better protective choices for themselves. Other things that I, you know, was just a little concerned with is, last time we had a discussion, we talked about lead. And if you have elevated lead levels in children, the state doesn't necessarily test the water if there's obvious sources of lead in the home. I think that's a mistake. And I would love an outcome of this being that if you have any children with elevated lead levels, you just go test their water at their home. It might be private well, it might be public water, but they have very old lead pipes in their old homes here. I think that would be great for public health of children in the state. And then, you know, there's always things that come up that we're worried about when you change zoning and stuff, which we have very little to do with. But, you know, when you build underground and you put, you know, petroleum products in your cars and chemicals underground at a sea level, when you start having more floods and more severe storms, that's when we start getting that environmental contamination that then does leach out in those certain circumstances. So it may not be appropriate for this group. I just wanted to put it out there. That's one of the things, the discussions we've had over the years as we change Portsmouth's landscape. Thank you.
Just on that last point, so I think having, there's talk about having a climate action plan in the next council, something that I support, you know, having some of the resiliency, you know, aspects and safe water be a part of that climate action plan, I think would be a good place to kind of, you know, rising sea level, which will affect Portsmouth, and then, you know, how do we protect against it? So I hope that it's going to be a bigger thing from the next council and, you know, a funded operation, but have a report to them from, you know, that gets going. I think would be a good place for the air petroleum products, etc.
One thing I would like to toss up there too is I had an experience with a neighbor in the last week. We were meeting together up at the taking our trash out, and I noticed that she was throwing away a couple of nonstick pans. And she's looking at me and she's there going, you know, getting rid of these because the Teflon is flaking off and they're dangerous, but I'm not sure if putting them in the recycling bin or throwing them in the trash is helping or hurting. And she asked me, is there any place in New Hampshire or in Portsmouth where I can take material that I know has PFAS in it so it can be recycled or disposed of properly? The answer, as far as I know, is no, which means essentially every time we put something like that back into the environment, whether it's an old Gore-Tex raincoat or footwear or nonstick cookware or furniture that was sprayed with Scotch Guard or anything like that, I know there's sort of a tendency to think this is something that was happening years ago and somehow we waved a magic wand and it's not happening anymore. But we're still contributing to the problem every single day, and there doesn't seem to be a way to get out of that. So what we're doing in terms of the water remediation and the testing becomes even more important because we haven't even begun to address the problem at the production end and the consumer end. So, you know, we're in a really tough spot with this stuff. And I think a lot of people don't really understand just how just the extent of the problem and how hard this is to solve. So, you know, the public education part of this and having a dialogue on it, being transparent about the results is so important, especially because, you know, we're living in an environment where a lot of the news media who might have covered a story like this and been all over communicating it, maybe 10 years ago, we would have seen 10-part series on things like this. They're just trying to figure out how to write news stories about what happened at Monday's council meeting by Wednesday. You know, it's a very challenging environment. And I don't think, I think any coverage that something like this gets in the media is a real bonus, but it's not something that we can anticipate. So it's sort of, I think a lot of the education is really going to need to be generated by people, you know, like ourselves who know a little bit more about the issue and who are willing to share the knowledge.
Offer some feedback. So first of all, I like how you recap the goals and the work we've done. I think it's been a really good substantive initiative to have this group. So thank you both for your leadership and getting us through it, because I think it's every meeting has been fascinating and relevant. So that's good. I think one area in the safe water realm that haven't dove into in a few years at the council is the dreaded Coakley landfill. So 3 or 4 years ago, I don't remember which year it was, previous council, you know, it was a bigger sort of issue in the paper a lot, and we put together a community meeting at a community campus. Actually, speaking of it, it was, I think, a good location for a community education event. And it wasn't perfect, and there were things that I think we could have done better with the event, but the intent, and I think what was somewhat successful, was getting a lot of the information out for the public to understand and allowing opportunity to ask different people about how it all worked and where Portsmouth's role was and responsibility was. And I think things, partly for those reasons, partly other reasons of people pushing on transparency, I think we've learned more about it. But I think it's something that periodically would be healthy to revisit so people understand it. I think when we were organizing that event, it would have been helpful if there was a group like this that maybe could have helped spearhead it or host it or put it on, you know, a mix of community and staff and council. It was staff and a couple of counselors. It was okay, but I think a group like this could do something like that. I think in the next, you know, you don't need to do that, I think, every year, but every couple of years or a few years, I think something like that.
significance would be helpful to be. And then I think I wanted to just go ahead and make a motion that our group recommend that the next mayor and council reconstitute the SWAC. So I'd like to make that motion so that that can be included in your report.
Second.
So do I have to ask if everyone is in favor? Sorry, I'm not good at this.
Yes.
Is everyone in favor of having the next council and the next mayor reinstate the SWAG?
Yes.
Does anyone disagree with that? And anyone on the phone to Laurel and Rich, please raise your hand or speak up if you're not in favor.
That pulls right into the recommendations.
So we had created some suggested recommendations too. And also, again, Brian and I will draft a report based on the feedback that everyone's giving us tonight. And if anything comes up, you know, after tonight that you thought of, or I know Hope couldn't make it tonight, certainly please email us as we can kind of consider everybody's input into this final report. But just a few recommendations that we have talked about. So thank you for making the motion to reinstate the SWAG next year. Again, we're going to plan for quarterly meetings. We want to try to schedule them a year in advance just so we're not like changing meetings, or, you know, we'll try to get it like a consistent date and time for quarterly meetings. And so Brian and I will work to do that for next year, and hope that and please, again, as Councillor McEachern said, if you're interested in renewing your membership, please make that known to us. Welcome everybody back for sure. The other thing, you know, we're gonna recommend, obviously, that we host our drinking water forum in early 2022 to educate the community on water quality, and we can talk about a lot of the things that were mentioned tonight. One thought too was, again, improving that communication. Was asked DPW to consider a quarterly newsletter to community members to share updates. And that can be on many different things, whether that's water quality, like new findings, water usage and conservation. So we know at times when we're not, you know, we're supposed to be limiting our water usage or whatnot, it'd be a good way if people signed up for these updates, they could get that information through an email.
Yeah, I would, just on that one, Andrea, just so everybody knows, I mean, we do, it's not per se a quarterly, but, you know, we have the update, we do the water supply update, which is more focused on the supply side, and of course, 2016, and again this summer up until it started raining in July and didn't stop, we were talking drought and getting that word out. And then on the water quality side, we're quite extensive, but, you know, you got to drill into the website. So I agree to maybe consolidate those with, you know, the quick little blurbs that are enough for people to read and absorb. And then those that want to do a deeper dive, go to the website and go there. So that's I'll work with Al, and I think, and Stephanie as well. Stephanie's been a great help to all the entire city on helping us, you know, do the updates, you know, the city manager's updates and the updates that go on the city's website and stuff. So I think, you know, working it down. And what we'll do is, and especially with this group, we can draft something up and get some feedback before we, you know, go live with it. That'd be helpful.
Yeah, I think it's just another way to engage with folks and maybe remind them. I know, like, just, yeah, little things too, like I had to buy a new washing machine and a new toilet this year, and I did the low flow ones and the energy efficient and was able to submit for rebates, and like reminding people of those things, you know, that's not a water quality issue, but conservation, like those are good things I think for people to keep in mind, you know, if they're just, there's more awareness around them, and that a newsletter might be a way to update folks that maybe aren't drilling in so deeply on some of these issues. Another recommendation for our report is to continue to monitor for contaminants and emerging concern. Not, you know, obviously PFAS, but obviously other things too. I know in our first meeting, Brian and Al did a good job of talking about all the contaminants they monitor for, and some, you know, that they keep closer eyes on or has had, you know, some that they've watched more closely than others. So we want to just make sure we're keeping an eye on all of those things. Continue to monitor for legislation at the state and federal level that will help address water quality issues in the city. Again, we've had an update already earlier this year, and David has put another update together for us tonight. And this is something that will continue to be ongoing, especially, you know, with so much awareness at the national and state level, as well as money being put towards the issue, which is super helpful. So I think that's something we're going to continue to see rapidly evolve over the next few years and stuff that at the city level, we should certainly be paying close attention to. And then one thought after we had our meeting with Brandon Kernan last time was to work with New Hampshire DES to identify and outreach private well owners in the city of Portsmouth to inform them on testing recommendations and labs. So obviously that's not under the purview of DPW, but we do know, I think there's about 80 private wells that New Hampshire DES is aware of in Portsmouth. And so if there's a way we can work with them to, you know, help educate those group of people to say, you know, Brandon touched upon the things that folks should be testing for in their wells and staying on top of that, that would be a good thing and something as a safe water advisory group, we should, you know, be trying to help facilitate and educate those private well owners in our city. And then lastly, you know, we talked about this, trying to find funding for the additional samples, both tap and water sources from Portsmouth to be analyzed by Eurofins for the 7D PFAS targeted list to, you know, confirm the PFPRA findings and, you know, do we see it in repeat samples? Is it more prevalent in one source over another? Give us a little bit more context to what that finding means so we can message that out to our community in a responsible way that has more context. So those were just some suggested recommendations that Ryan and I had come up with, and certainly you all gave us some others as well. But if there's any additional thoughts, you know, again, feel free to share them. And then lastly, just wanted to be clear that Brian and I are going to draft a report after tonight, you know, kind of recapping our year, the topics we discussed, the recommendations that we have. We'll send it to all of you to review and give us feedback, of course, before we finalize it. And then the plan would be to submit that to the city council, as well as a brief presentation to the council in their final meeting on December 20th. And that's it. So I guess I just want to pause real quick to see if anyone has any other thoughts or anything you want to add.
Just on the, it was open discussion and it was listed there. So I want to touch on the turf field discussion that we had at this meeting was rescheduled to accommodate. Couple of takeaways from there, and I'll try to go through them quickly. It's a much larger conversation. We'll have a report back on that. But the council asked for PFAS-free field. I've learned that that's a difficult thing to ask for in general. But the atmospheric PFAS that saw that made it all the way to Canada kind of affects the testing. It was testing done by another third-party group outside of the city of Portsmouth that was brought to our attention. At that time, we had a meeting. I can't say we figured anything out at the last meeting, except for that the company or the representatives of the company, if I'm remembering this incorrectly, please correct me, said that there was PFAS in the soccer fields and that they would provide, or that we could request that data. Now, I don't know if that data is, I think it's been requested. I don't think we received that. I think the latest is that we're going to have a conversation next Tuesday. But the takeaway is representatives from both Andrea, Ted, myself, the city attorney, the city manager and the assistant city manager are going to meet to discuss testing around that and try to figure out a path forward. I think it's likely going to be difficult to figure out what that is, but trying to do that with as much data as we can get and understand, and hopefully come back with a analyze the risk assessment of that for the community. At least that's, you know, partially my goal to go through with that. And then in the future to have better process in place so that, you know, when council asks for something that, you know, might not be possible, it's not just these, if the council says, you know, we want PFAS for your field, and then in order to test that, it's 29 known, you know, PFAS is a known concern, that we get a little bit more information around that and hopefully make a better decision, but or a more informed decision. But the other thing is, you know, it was a interesting conversation. I learned an enormous amount. I think anybody that's interested in PFAS should watch the conversation that happened in the corners, but on Zoom. I learned something, and I thought the conversation was important to have, and hopefully that we are going to continue our laser focus on making sure that health and wellness of every community member is supported, and we will have more information at the next council meeting for that. But I saw it up there, and I meant to come back, and then you went over the slides, and I didn't want to feel like I was just ignoring that, since the assistant mayor basically said, Daglin and these other folks like Andrea have to figure it out now that we spent 2 hours and talked about it, couldn't figure it out. So hopefully we'll have an update on the next council meeting.
Would you repeat those people were again? So you and Andrea?
Yeah, so at the end of the meeting, so the meeting went to about, I think it was
six. Going to go forward?
Yeah, so we were, so myself, the city manager, assistant city manager, Suzanne Woodland, Andrea Amico, and Ted Jankowski are going to have a conversation on the testing. You know, testing, so I know we try to keep these meetings to 8. You know, we went into the meeting thinking, there was evidence found, or there was, you know, Ted grabbed some samples that were discarded and tested those. I think it's likely that there could have been contamination on those samples, but in the process of the conversation, they said that it was likely just PFAS in those, they just weren't the ones that we would test for. And so understanding that, want to ask them what that, what the actual chemical, instead of spending the money and figuring out, okay, we're going to find out what that PFAS is, we're first just going to ask the manufacturer, since it's not this, these ones of concern, which chemical is that? And then can we have a conversation around that, and then in terms of testing and or path forward, it would be around the safety of that. Substance, which is in the plates of grass. Does that answer your question?
Yeah,
I guess your question was assumed.
Yeah, assume, thank you.
I guess the only thing I'd add to that is, one of the questions that I raised to the city was around testing water leaching off the field too, because that's something, I think for me, there's two concerns. It's like what are the risks of people playing on the field if they're exposed to PFAS? I don't know that. So that's a question. And then the other question is, if there is PFAS in the turf, will it leach and will it go into surrounding wetlands? And how will that, and stormwater, and how could that affect drinking water supplies or surrounding waterways? And so I think the question around the testing and the leaching is something as a Safe Water Advisory Group we should follow, and kind of see as these conversations progress. And so that's, I think, I thought you did a good recap, and that was the only point I would add. It's just that we need to, for me, I'm concerned about I don't want to add additional PFAS pollution into our community, because we're already kind of grappling with a lot from many sources. Hopefully, ease the toll of the landfill. So we don't want to add additional sources. So I just want to make sure that if we're able to get confirmation that PFAS is in the turf, or if we have to do additional testing to prove PFAS is in the turf, that whatever is found, or acknowledge that we, as a city, pay attention to how that could be.
Yeah, one last point on that, and I'm not really, so I just jumped in. So on the leaching part, I think is, I would be, so we test water outputs in terms of, this is a question for Brian.
Sure.
So we're testing different, areas, and we're monitoring those for different areas. Or contaminants,
the PFAS,
or just in general, we test source. Are we testing? Better way to phrase it: are we testing areas around Portsmouth, not just this, specific site for, stormwater runoff?
Oh yes, areas? Well, stormwater, but PFAS is not one of the constituents we sample for. There are many other parameters that are required to be sampled for. The biggest one, surfactants. So they're really looking for, like oils and the things that we generally run across every day. That was spoken all about, you know, the cars we drive and the car, you know, the oil that leaks off the car, the antifreeze and stuff like that. So we test for that. It's not required to do the PFAS sampling. The thing, and the state is working on surface water regulations. I guess we're going to offer David an opportunity to give us an update on legislation and stuff, but they're yet to be full. Sampling of, let me say, dirtier water is a bit more difficult. I know Laurel, Dr. Schrader jumped in here and talked about, you know, the difficulty of some of the short chain compounds, but also solids and sludge. You hear the word, you know, sludge or biosolids, and all those are much more difficult to get a test of, and the testing results and valid tests and duplicates and stuff like that. So I think that's a long-winded answer to the question, but the PFAS testing we do is strictly the drinking water side right at the moment. All of our sources of supply, we've done tap samples, both just to see and also through a study that we did with testing for peas to kind of analyze, are we seeing at the tap what we see at the source? And that pretty much is the case, though it varies because where your tap is might be a little bit different from where someone else's is, and that blend of water, you know, varies. But we've got a really good database of all of our sources of supply. When it comes to stormwater, we're most interested in what we're seeing at the reservoir, because, you know, that's pretty much stormwater is what refills that reservoir. So we sample that quarterly, and to date, though there's some presence of PFAS, it's, you know, in the single digits, low single digits. So that, you know, to sample the runoff of the field, you know, would, I think it would be very interesting. These rainwater samples are interesting to me. I don't know how they collect them and that. I'm sure that equipment is different than just filling up a bottle. But certainly they'd have to want to get the rainwater because that's what's falling on the field. And then if you're getting runoff, then you can at least have that baseline to compare to.
Yes, I only had a comment on that meeting. You know, I think it's important for us, the city, and whether it's this issue or other issues looking at contaminants, healthy water, is to just be mindful of priorities, but be mindful of, you know, like so many hours, days, weeks, staff, resources. I think with this turf, you know, a lot of the description of the turf itself, the PFAS in it, was about it being inert or insoluble. And so presence of PFAS doesn't mean the same thing in all contexts, right? And so if you're talking about, you know, dangerous drinking water or being dangerous to somebody being around it, the context is critical. Without the context, you know, it's you know, we're not, I think, is having as meaningful of a discussion. So I think we have to have that in part of this conversation. You know, I've heard the one scientist talk about the turf would be 185 degrees and mixed with a certain kind of acid in order to activate the PFAS. And I'm sure I'm oversimplifying what was there, but I think that's an important part of that conversation. And it's an interesting contrast to something like what brought up tonight with the PFPRA, I had all the letters right, where that's, you know, all right, drinking water, that's a different, you know, context than inert, insoluble thing on the field that you're not drinking gallons of, and, you know, coming through a different testing system. And no offense to Ted, but yeah, you got the turf out of a dumpster, and that sort of chip, that doesn't sound like a, you know, as good of a testing method as what the groups did about the turf. So I think all of those things are important for us when we're figuring out how to spend our focus and time and effort. I had comments on something else. So the one other thing I wanted to mention for this group, and
don't know if it's relative to your report when I'm thinking about, you know, next year or the next couple of years as a group, but would be to take the term advisory to heart and think in terms of opportunities for advocacy, right? So I've said I'm on the sustainability committee, and a lot of what I kept hammering home to them was you can speak up to the city council or you can speak up into the community. You don't have to necessarily wait for the council to ask you to bring something up. You can, you know, there could be opportunities around budget time where there's something that's important that we're working on. There could be opportunities with legislation that's happening, yes, federally, but at the state level. So the legislative committee is going to be active looking at things that are coming up. You've got a legislator on the group, that's great. And perhaps with cooperation with the city, somebody from a group like this could, you know, testify. You know, so there's other opportunities like that that I think you should be mindful of to go ahead and, you know, obviously this was our first time. It's great. I think you're doing the report the way you are. But you can be thinking over the course of a year or two in a council term of periodic opportunities to bring things up that the group may feel is worthwhile.
For example, if they build new fields, aren't they supposed to be building more fields at community campus?
Undetermined. We have the fields, the spot we've acquired that. There's also this public-private partnership thing that's potentially happening, potentially not. But all of that would be an ample time to weigh in on what, you know, what this group's vision would be, or as individuals too.
Sure, no, I was just trying to comment. If we were building more fields, hypothetically, for example, we could weigh in on Portsmouth taking a more precautionary principle approach to that kind of decision making in the future.
Yes.
I know David's pitching.
Your slides did not come through. I'm sorry. This computer, I can't pull it. I didn't log into personal email. So if you got what you need to say and works just verbally, that you give us an update.
Maybe to kind of put things into perspective a little bit. So this past legislative session wasn't a session when we got a lot of big things done. The really big thing that we got done in 2020 was making sure that we had the toughest state PFAS standards for drinking water in the country. So New Hampshire, when it comes to that, became a model for other states. Some things that we did manage to accomplish is we extended the statute of limitations relative to damages, civil damages, from 3 years to 6 years. That's because if you've been hurt by PFAS contamination, illnesses and effects and things like that may not show up for years. So extending it to 6 years gives people more time to file for damages. One of the other things is there is some money available, state funding available to municipal water treatment wastewater systems to treat PFAS contamination. It's using American Rescue Plan funds, but these are not the same funds that we're talking about as part of the infrastructure package. As Andrea alluded to, that's a much, much bigger pot of money. Anything that's coming from the state of New Hampshire, you know, think of it as, you know, basically 1 or 2 years of funding, and then it goes away unless another legislator, in another session, we basically renew it. So this is temporary. One of the big things that we did manage to accomplish was putting together a solid waste working group to sort of begin to address the issue of where we actually put all the trash in New Hampshire, with the landfill starting to fill up. That's a concern to folks in this group because a lot of the landfills generate leachate, and a lot of that leachate just winds up being dumped into local rivers and dumped into rivers untreated. So that's something that'll help a lot. Things that are actually coming up for a
coming up in the next session. One of the things that you had alluded to is, you know, the importance of making sure that children are receive lead testing. So there's a bill out there, and I'm a co-sponsor of it, that would establish blood level testing requirement for children entering daycare and public schools. There would also be a reporting requirement to report the results back to parents. There is another bill that would require PFAS testing of drinking water and childcare facilities in schools across the state. Another bill would require warning labels on consumer products containing PFAS, so people would have a better idea of what they're purchasing, and they can make different consumer decisions based on what they're seeing in some of the labels. So those are just a few things. There are also two surface water, two bills that would actually govern surface water PFAS standards in New Hampshire. One of them basically would mirror the drinking water standards. The other one would actually get into some additional PFAS contaminants as well. So there are a couple of different bills there. My hope is that somehow those will emerge from the committee being, you know, one thing that everybody can agree to. But that one in particular, it's going to be one where it's going to be really important to hear from people sort of outside of the legislative bubble, you know, on what this means, what's the value of doing something like that, what's the cost of doing something like that to local communities, what's the cost of not doing something like that for local communities. So one of the things that I'm really hoping is that one of the outcomes of a committee like this, I think as Cook was saying, is that we all become better educated about this, and more people from the city feel comfortable going up to Concord to testify, because on so many of these bills, it's maybe one person for DES, and then it's just legislators talking to each other, you know, testifying, asking each other questions, and having people from cities and towns, you know, with experience and perspective on these issues, is just extremely valuable. And it can really, really help a good bill, and it can kill the bad ones. So it really does make a difference. So I'm kind of hoping that there are ways that I can see maybe more of us up in Concord testifying on some of these bills. And one of the things that I will do is put together a summary of all of the PFAS and water related bills that are coming up in 2022, like I did for 2021, and I'll get that to you.
If we could just turn, I know we haven't heard from Rich, and if Laurel had any other comments, I just want to make sure we don't forget about them.
I'll just say thanks, everyone. It's been a great year. I've really enjoyed being part of these meetings, and I've also learned a lot, and happy to continue to be a part of this group moving forward, and really enjoying this discussion tonight, thinking, you know, about the full life cycle of water. I've enjoyed the talks that have kind of linked the water quality and water quantity issues together. I think that's an important thread to consider in the future. And thinking about the sort of our chemical footprints and thinking upstream in terms of sources of pollution as well. I think Portsmouth has an opportunity to be a leader on that as well. So thanks so much, and hope to see you in person one of these days. It's a little harder to be part of the discussion remotely. So yeah, thanks for including me.
Thanks so much. Rich, did you have any comments or thoughts that you wanted to share?
You'll need to unmute. You do, Rich.
Hello.
Oh,
hi. We can hear you.
I thought I was muted here for, I guess I was.
Okay, we can hear you now, Rich, so we'd love to hear any comments or thoughts you have on the discussion.
No, I did get a message, though, that I And I was mumbling stuff, and I guess I wasn't muted. I'm sorry if I interrupted anything.
No worries. Do you have any thoughts or comments before we kind of wrap up our discussion regarding the last year or the report or any recommendations our scribe should be making?
No, I think you guys covered pretty much everything. I'm kind of interested to see what's happening with that sports field and all that confusion around that, though.
Okay, great. Thanks so much, Rich.
Okay. Have a good Thanksgiving, guys.
So I know I mentioned I'm not only part of this overall PFAS, but I drank the water. And I know Andrea's continuing, and we're trying to continue to reach out and get more people to participate, because the information is hopefully going to be useful for the long term. But as a participant, I got my blood sampled in 2016. It was high, but again, as I said earlier, I sort of eased my mind a bit by looking back on past data. So I finally got the results. So they did follow-up testing, and I got my results for 2019. So that was 2 years ago. So it had been 3 years since my first sample. And initially, when I opened it at home, I thought, I'm high, oh my, it had been such a long time, I didn't really have a reference point. So I just grabbed them, the first thing I did, and I got them on the weekend. So when I went in my office Monday morning, I think it was 2 weeks ago, the first thing I did was grab my previous samples and I compared the two, and I sat down and compared the numbers. And the good news is, overall, everything had dropped. And then I looked at some of the literature, and the literature talks about half-lives. So these are basically, if something is in your system, how many years would it take for half of it to come out? And it, like almost to a compound, I was right in line with that. So overall, my blood had dropped 36%. So that's good news. I'm still drinking the water. I've never stopped drinking the water. I live in Portsmouth now, so I drink more of the water than I did 2-3 years ago. But that was good news for me. I'm willing to get another blood test, but I guess it's not part of the study. They keep testing in subsequent years. So I don't fully understand some of the long-term medical monitoring, but it's been 2 years since my last test, so I would hope to get it tested again. It would continue to show that progression. Something like that is useful, and at least it's a good news story to some degree there. And I know we talk overall, and Al and I are digging deep into numbers all the time and looking at charts and looking at trends and all that stuff, but the Haven well had very high, when we talk about contamination, the Haven well was really contaminated. So, but it was in the heart and soul of, the fire that they had extinguished the fire. But at the last meeting, I did show the data that the Air Force's treatment system themselves, that they've had online 2 years, doing a really good job of reducing that amount there. So, just started, all these things give me, perspective. And I know it's like, that's what helps me sort of, kind of package all this stuff in a certain sense as to, as we've been talking here, the risks and the realities and the unknowns. We certainly know, even in this group, but I think a lot more than when we had our first meeting. So, I think that'll continue next year, but I think it's a heavy load for all of us to keep working in a realm that has so much unknown, and that's not going to go away. And I know Al, I speak for Al too, that it's not the funnest business to fill water bottles and send them off the lab and wait 2 weeks to see what the results are going to be. It's like, there's a lot of tests we do that we can go look right this minute and see how we're performing. And you saw this when you came to our facility, but we don't have the magic test for PFAS yet that can just give you that running amount that is right there and all forms. But anyway, I just wanted to add that. And if we've got people out there in the listening audience that haven't signed up for the study, hopefully they will.
There's two PFAS health studies going on. A study with CDC, HSDR, and that's actually closing December 31st. So if anybody knows anyone who was exposed for 2014, kids or adults, they're also recruiting kids that haven't drank the water. So then there's children that are 5 and older that would be interested in participating. That would be helpful too. And then there's also PFAS Reach, which is another PFAS study for kids ages 3 to 8. And they're looking for their moms who were exposed to drinking water before 2014, or in the 8 range, they just increased the age. It could be even kids that were drinking water at daycare for a short period of time. So both studies are actively recruiting, and I know the city's been helpful in trying to help us spread the word, handing out flyers at the Hazardous Waste Day, putting information in their newsletter. I applied to march in the Portsmouth Parade with signs. So doing everything we can to try to spread the word in many different ways to get our community participate so we can contribute to the science. So thanks for bringing up the health studies and giving us the opportunity to raise it here too. And so I think with that, we just have to ask if there's any public comment.
If we have no attendees.
Okay, and I think we can conclude our SWAG meeting and look for a report, a draft report from Brian and I in the next week or two that you guys can give feedback on, and we'll present that off to the council, and then we'll be in touch next year about next steps for our new reinstated SWAG next year.
Move to adjourn. Second.
Yes.
All right.
Approved. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Thanks, Kevin. Sure.